الحمد لله، نحمده سبحانه ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهد الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا وعظيمنا وزعيمنا وحبيبنا محمدًا صلى الله عليه وسلم قد بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في سبيل دينه حتى أتاه اليقين. فاللهم اجزه عنا وعن والدينا وعن الإسلام والمسلمين خير ما جازيت به نبيًا عن قومه ورسولًا عن أمته. اللهم أحينا على سنته، وآمتنا على ملته، واحشرنا تحت لوائه، وأوردنا حوضه، واسقنا من يده الشريفة شربة هنيئة لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا. اللهم آمين. We have been talking about our manners with Allah as it is manifested in our relationship with Allah, our relationship with His book. And today's topic is a latch on topic. Excuse me. It's an issue that is relevant to the same topic, which is our relationship with what is most important that Allah has taught us in the Quran. That is to know, to understand, and to relate to His will, and to give it the priority it should be given. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us in the Quran what He wills for this life to be. He willed for His creation in terms of men and jinns to be free and to exercise their own, albeit limited, but free will. Meaning Allah, out of His divine wisdom, He saw fit to make us independent and free in our will, which means you do what you will. فَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيُؤْمِنْ وَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيَكْفُرْ. Anyone who wants to believe, let him believe. And he doesn't want to believe, let him not believe. That far. The freedom to recognize and to accept Allah or to deny Him is a divine will. This freedom could have been taken away from us from the beginning of creation, as we know it is taken away from many others of the creations of Allah, if not all of them. They don't have that kind and that level of free will. Our free will is limited by certain limitations because of practical, legitimate creational reasons. Allah could have created man a flying object. Allah could have given man the power He has given to other creations. So Allah tells us just to inquire and to reflect and to ponder and to think. He tells us, أَأَنْتُمْ أَشَدُّ خَلْقًا أَمِ السَّمَاءِ بَنَاهَا. Are you more formidable? Are you stronger in your creation, in your built up, as heavens, or are they greater and more formidable than you are? The answer is obvious. We can't match. We can't match in our creation heavens, vastly because we don't know even what the word heaven means in reality. As-sama in Arabic, in the Quranic language, means anything above your head. And we use it to refer to heaven as that high object over us, over the universe, and we don't know what actually it is. It is just something higher than we are. So we call it as-sama. أَأَنْتُمْ أَشَدُّ خَلْقًا أَمِ السَّمَاءِ بَنَاهَا. Allah built it. رَفَعَ سَمْكَهَا فَسَوَّاهَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has raised it up high and determined it is crust, how thick it would be. And he made it even. Nothing is crooked in the structure of the sky. وَأَغْطَشَ لَيْلَهَا وَأَخْرَجَ ضُحَاهَا. He made the night dark and he made the duha lighter and more illuminated than the night, to show you the difference. He showed us the difference between days and nights. As we go through the days and the nights in the winter, where the night is longer and the day is shorter, and in the summer it is the opposite, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls it an ayah. إن في خلق السماوات والأرض واختلاف الليل والنهار لآيات. So the day and the night are not only different in terms of darkness and light, but also they differ in length and shortness. Almost every day, but we don't feel it that much because it comes in minutes. So it comes gradually. And in this, there is a great ayah that everything that you want to achieve without shaking the boat or rocking the boat or sinking the boat, do it slowly, do it gradually. So graduality becomes one of the greatest sunnah and laws of Allah in managing and controlling this universe. So Allah does everything in due proportion, both in creation and in evolution and in progress and change. So we should learn from nature how nature responds to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How the mountains are told by Allah, as we read the Quran, Ya jibalu awwibi ma'ah. O mountains, chant and join the chanting of Prophet Dawood, because Allah loves his chanting. So he orders the mountain to chant with him, to join him and rhyme with him and sync their chanting, the praise of Allah with Dawood. Amazing. Amazing. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about those who have been taken out by way of torment and punishment because of denying Allah, refusing to submit their will to the will of Allah, when he says, فَمَا بَكَتْ عَلَيْهِمُ السَّمَاءُ وَالْأَرْضِ, that heavens and earth never shed a tear over their demise. They go and they mean nothing. And that is true for all of us. Even when the son of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam died, and the people started to say, oh, the sky looks like this, the sky looks like that, like some of the allegations that you see from some people, that the sky is dark today because somebody died or somebody is born, so it is bright. And the Prophet ﷺ corrected all of this superstitiousness, and he says, "Inna samaa," heaven does not change for anybody's death or birth. It has nothing to do with that. So, what I'm trying to relate to you is, everything in the universe created by Allah goes with Allah's commands. The only creation that is given the freedom to disobey is us. And let me bring you the issue that we have been talking about for a few weeks. That is not good manners. It is not good manners to be created by Allah and to worship anyone else. To be provided by Allah and all your thanks go to someone else. To be supported by Allah, to be cured by Allah, and you seek help from anyone else, where the help of Allah is the only help needed. So brothers and sisters, Allah told us what He wants from us and what He wants for us. What He wants from us is, اعبدوا الله ولا تشركوا به شيئا. Worship Allah, be submissive to Allah, and associate none with Him. Well, It's an amazing kind of combination. Why does the Quran say اعبدوا الله and then it says ولا تشركوا به شيئا? Worship Allah and don't associate. Isn't it a given that if you worship Allah that you actually would never associate anyone with him? The reality is no. No, and the most disturbing part of this reality is we Muslims do not ever recognize this fact. We think once I'm a Muslim, I'm no mushrik. I want you to pay attention to this. Once I am a mushrik, I am never a mushrik. And this theoretically should be true. But when you obey Allah in one way and you disobey Allah deliberately and intentionally, then whom are you serving on the second case? You're serving either your ego, you're serving yourself, what you perceive as your interest, or anything else, but you're not serving Allah by disobeying Allah. The Prophet ﷺ said, أَلَا إِنَّ سِلْعَةَ اللَّهِ غَالِيَةٌ. The commodity of Allah is quite expensive. أَلَا إِنَّ سِلْعَةَ اللَّهِ الْجَنَّةِ. The commodity of Allah is paradise. أَلَا إِنَّ مَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ لَا يُؤْخَذُ بِمَعْصِيَةِ اللَّهِ. Pay attention to this one, the last one. Whatever Allah has, which means He has to give you or He has prepared for you, will not be gotten by disobeying Allah. You can't get what Allah has promised by disobeying Allah. So what do you need to do? What we need to do is to always check on our faith and on our submission that we are committed to submit to Allah, not only when it is easy or convenient, not only when it pays off and it serves our interest, not only because I make a worldly gain out of it, but even if I lose every worldly thing, I still have to submit to Allah, because whatever you have is from Him. وَمَا بِكُم مِّن نِّعْمَةٍ فَمِنَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ إِذَا مَسَّكُمُ الضُّرُّ فَإِلَيْهِ تَجْأَرُونَ ثُمَّ إِذَا كَشَفَ الضُّرَّ عَنكُمْ إِذَا فَرِيقٌ مِّنكُم بِرَبِّهِمْ يُشْرِكُونَ. Brothers, we cannot ask Allah all the time, and when He asks us for the simplest of things, we check our mood, we check our inclination, we check the convenience of what He is asking, we check the calendar, we check everything except His pleasure. We factor and calculate everything except what pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is a serious flaw, both in our thinking and in the way we relate to Allah, and it is reflected as a matter of bad manners with Allah. In the Hadith Qudsi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I have a serious matter to take up with the jinns and the humans. Inni wal jinn wal ins lafi naba'in azim. What it is? He says, akhluqu wa yu'badu ghayri. I create and others are being worshipped. Arzuqu وَيُشْكَرُ سِوَاي. I provide, but thanks are going to others. أَنَا أَكْلَأُكُمْ بِاللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ. I take care of you by day and by night. And I shower you with my blessings. And you are challenging me with your disobedience. It's an amazing statement. How is it that we are challenging Allah with our disobedience? Do you know when you, I'm just going to give you an example so that the issue comes close, but not to compare, of course. Do you know when you tell your child or your student, don't do this, and then a few minutes later, he's looking you in the eye and he's doing exactly what you told him not to do? How do you feel? You feel challenged. What is the challenge? The challenge is your child or your student is telling you, let me see what you do. In his action, he's challenging your authority, and he's challenging your judgment, and he's challenging your power to do anything. What do you then do? You have to discipline that child, because it's not in his good interest to be rebellious, especially at young age. So the point I'm trying to get is, when we disobey Allah, when we go against His will, then we are challenging His authority, His power, and His ability to do whatever He wants to do. Could Allah be challenged? So Allah will keep it for you. And then next time you ask Him for something, He's gonna challenge you to get it your way. He's gonna leave you to your means. And the Quran speaks to that issue. مَنْ كَانَ يَظُنُّ أَلَّنْ يَنْصُرَهُ اللَّهُ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَلَا فِي الْآخِرَةِ فَلْيَمْدُدْ بِسَبَبٍ إِلَى السَّمَاءِ ثُمَّ لِيَقْطَعْ فَلْيَنْظُرْ هَلْ يُذْهِبَنَّ كَيْدُهُ مَا يَغِيظُ. Anyone who doesn't believe that Allah will give him what he had promised of support and victory and everything he is asking for in this life or in the hereafter, let him build a tower or a reason or something to take him up to heaven. And then let him cut that means and see if he can achieve his purpose, if he can get what he wants. And the answer is obvious. No one can get what they want except if Allah allows it to happen. That is also mentioned to us in the hadith very clearly. وَعْلَمْ أَنَّ الْأُمَّةِ لَوْ اجْتَمَعَتْ عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَنْفَعُوكَ بِشَيْءٍ فَلَنْ يَنْفَعُوكَ إِلَّا بِشَيْءٍ قَدْ كَتَبَهُ اللَّهُ لَكَ. Be aware that if the whole humanity got together to help you get something done that you want, they would not be able to do it unless Allah allows it to happen. وَإِنْ اجْتَمَعَتْ عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَضُرُّوكَ بِشَيْءٍ فَلَنْ يَضُرُّوكَ إِلَّا بِمَا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكَ بِشَيْءٍ قَدْ كَتَبَهُ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكَ. They will never be able to hurt you if they got together with anything except that which Allah allows them to. So He is giving you full protection, both in terms of blessings and in terms of calamities and difficulties. He says very clearly, مَا يَفْتَحِ اللَّهُ لِلنَّاسِ مِنْ رَحْمَةٍ فَلَا مُمْسِكَ لَهَا. Whatever Allah releases or opens of doors of blessings and gates of showering with bounties and goodness, nobody can hold it. And whatever He holds, nobody can release. What does this mean? It means that He meant your life to be exclusively secured under His will, under His divine control, so that you feel secure and safe and protected by no one other than Him. Your safety is in His hand. Your security is in His hand. No matter how many people get together to help you or hurt you, none will do that except if Allah wills it. Why is this? Because Allah wants to tie your will to His will, to bless you. وَلَوْ شَاءَ رَبُّكَ لَجَعَلَ النَّاسَ أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً وَلَا يَزَالُونَ مُخْتَلِفِينَ. Had Allah willed it, He would have made the whole humanity as one community. But they will continue yet to be different, because so long as we have the free will, we will continue to have differences. I want something, you want something different. You think it is extremely cold, a person visiting from Canada, he will just envy you for the sunshine you have. That's a fact. We feel differently, we appreciate things differently, and as such, we will continue to judge things differently. So Allah wants to protect all of us. If all of our wills are tied to His, then we can be united. If I want to please Allah and you want to please Allah, we can easily unite and work together and live together and love each other. And do not consider that your good may be bad for me or my good could be bad for you. Because we all love and want Allah's pleasure. This is what is most important in our adab and manners and etiquette in relating to Allah, that we do not let our wills stray away from the straight path. وَأَنَّ هَذَا صِرَاطِي مُسْتَقِيمًا فَاتَّبِعُوهُ وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا السُّبُلِ فَتَفَرَّقَ بِكُمْ عَنْ سَبِيلِهِ. The Prophet ﷺ recited this ayah, and this path of mine is a straight path. Then follow it, and do not follow other paths, lest it takes you away and it takes you astray from my path. Amazing statement. When he recited this ayah, he drew a line in the sand, a straight line. And from that line, he branched out other lines, right and left. And he said, this is the path of Allah, and those are other paths. And he recited the ayah to show the companions what it means to stray away from Allah. Don't take any exit that takes you any farther away from Allah. In fact, if you are on one, make a U-turn and go back to the straight path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is how we align our will with the will of Allah. Let us take this to more practical issues. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about our relationships with our spouses, wives or husbands, when he says, وَلَهُنَّ مِثْلُ الَّذِي عَلَيْهِنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, and to them, referring to women, is what is similar to what is on them, which means what is owed them of rights is similar and consummate to what is on them of duties and responsibilities. And if that is true, then it is also true for men that what is on them is also consummate to what is for them. In other words, your wife's rights are your duties and responsibilities towards your family. And your rights on your wife is her responsibility towards you and the family. This is how it should be if we follow the Quran. But if you want to nitpick and misapply the Quran, then you pick another ayah and another hadith and twist its meaning to hit against what Allah is saying. To hit against it. Oh brother, Shaykh, but what about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, الرِّجَالُ قَوَّمُونَ عَلَى النِّسَاءِ, men are leaders over women. So this is not equality like the West. Brothers, we're not talking equality or inequality. We are talking about duties and responsibilities. The marital relationship, it has to go according to the design that Allah meant it to go, which is the duties of the women are the rights of the man, and the rights of the man are the duties of the women. And the opposite is equally true. That is not to mean that all of her duties are exactly the same like the man. Nor is the opposite also true. It is not. The Quran says, وَلَهُنَّ مِثْلُ. The Quran doesn't say, وَلَهُنَّ الَّذِي, because the woman will carry the woman duty, and the man will carry the man's duty. Right? Whatever those may be, and the norm gets in to define what is not already defined in the Quran or the Sunnah. So, for example, the Quran defined that if the woman earns money and the man earns money, the Quran says, لِلْرِجَالِ نَصِيبٌ مِّمَّا اكْتَسَبُوا وَلِلْنِسَاءِ نَصِيبٌ مِّمَّا اكْتَسَبْنَا. men have a share of what they earn and women have a share of what they earn. Isn't this reciprocal and mutual? It is. And the beginning of this ayah is وَلَا تَتَمَنَّوْا مَا فَضَّلَ اللَّهُ بِهِ بَعْضَكُمْ عَلَى بَعْضٍ. Don't ask to be given what you are not given that is given to the other. فَضَّلَ doesn't mean prefer, but it means to give out of his bounties, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we have to adjust our concepts so that our relationship inside the family is consistent with, not contrary to, what Allah tells us in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that men are expected to spend on the family. Then some women would take this to mean that she can be a millionaire and ask him and demand him to spend as if he himself were the millionaire. When he is not, he can't. So she cannot ask for what is beyond his means. And he cannot pay or provide for what is less proportionate to what Allah has given him. So Allah makes and gives you the balance. Allah says, لِيُنْفِقْ ذُو سَعَةٍ مِنْ سَعَةِهِ. Everyone should spend from whatever means Allah has given him. And I want you to pay attention to one word. مِنْ لِيُنْفِقْ مِنْ سَعَةِهِ. Not لِيُنْفِقْ سَعَةَهِ. Not to spend all what you have, but spend proportionate to what Allah has provided you. وَمَنْ قُدِرَ عَلَيْهِ رِزْقُهُ فَلْيُنْفِقْ مِمَّا آتَاهُ اللَّهِ. If Allah has made your provision limited, again, spend proportionately to what Allah has given you of limited provision. So we have to take the entirety of all the ayat that talks about family relationship, both emotionally, psychologically, and financially, and physically, all of what it takes to make each other happy. If we do not do this, and we don't, unfortunately, that means either we decided to live with our ignorance and lead life the way we want and ignore the will of Allah and ignore the ayat in the Quran, the guidance, the light, the comfort, the security, the blessings of studying and following the Quran, or else we've decided to leave our Islam altogether. Because if Allah talks to you and you ignore deliberately what he is telling you, there is no way you can ask then if your will is consistent with Allah, because you don't know what his will is. If you ignore what he's telling you, if you don't read the Quran regarding your assignment, your responsibility as a human being in this life, then how do you care for others who come under your care and expect your support and your provision to cover them as well? It is like another example. If you are a physician, and some of our community members are physicians, and you do not study when life begins, when life ends, according to the Quran and the understanding of scholars and, you know, scholarly councils of fuqaha and stuff like this, how do you then determine to pull the plug on a patient? How do you do this? Do you just make up your mind by the physical science that you have and determine that that person is dead or not dead? Or some unfortunately do that based on their forecast, their prognosis. They say he is not likely to get back to his life as it was again. Who said that a patient who is in a coma is expected to recover fully? Allah knows if he will ever recover or not. But you pull the plug without letting Allah guide your judgment is to ignore his will. He gave this person life, and you are deciding to take it out based on what? If not your study of Islam, your study of the Quran. So there is a lot of issues that we can bring under this topic, the topic of should we relate our will to the will of Allah, or should we live our life according to either what is comfortable or what's convenient or what is legal or what is popular. Brothers, if you live by any of these criteria, you are not living as a Muslim. You are living as a human being, and maybe a decent one, but there is no manners with Allah whatsoever in making your comfort or popularity or being accepted as a criterion for making a decision. It has to be based on clear knowledge of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So as a matter of good manners, every one of us owe it to yourself. You owe it to yourself, and you owe it to your family, and you owe it to those who depend on you, like your children and mates and servants and everybody that gets in touch with you. You owe it to yourself and to all of them to always check with Allah. If He's pleased, you go ahead, and if He may not be pleased, you review what you are about to do, whether it is a decision or a choice or anything else. Brothers and sisters, life and the path to the hereafter is full of choices. It is like, I don't want to make it look like a silly something like a game or a play, because sometimes the Quran describes this life as a play. But if you play by the rules of Allah, then you win. And this is what the Quran calls al-muflihun, those who are winners. If you play against the rules of Allah, then you are a loser. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْخَاسِرُونَ. So you have to always ask, it is like playing any game, chess or anything else. Every move, if you want to win, you calculate. And what is the calculation about? You make a move based on what you think the other side will do, right? You expect him to play this way, then you make a choice as to what to do so that you could win at the end of the game. We need to check with Allah. No comparison again. We need to check with Allah as to what it means to Him and what it means for our destination, what it means for our faith with Allah, the move that we are going to take, whether it is marriage or divorce or business or accepting a career or joining a school or joining anything, any club, any group. You have to ask, does this please Allah or does it not? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us always please Him in everything. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا مولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله. وبعد، brothers and sisters, our manners with Allah is an issue that we will continue to live with for the rest of our life. Whether we can capture everything in a sermon or 10 or 15 or not is not the issue. The issue is every part of our life is held by a string in the hands of Allah, and every day that string is getting shorter. It's not getting longer. Every day that goes by, it never comes back again until the day of judgment, and it only comes as a witness. In the hadith, there is not a day when the sun rises except that a caller calls from heaven saying, O son of man, O son of Adam, I am a new day and I'm a witness over your deeds. I'm a witness over you. So take as much advantage of me, as much benefit of me as you can, because once I go, I never come back until the day of judgment. If we understand what this says, then we will act accordingly. That every day is a new gift. It's a new gift, a new chance from Allah. Allah is opening a new gate for you to reclaim your rightful place in paradise. And Allah says that He created us to give us mercy. That is His will. His will is to give us mercy. But it is our choices that can take us somewhere else. اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت وعافنا فيمن عافيت وتولنا فيمن توليت وقنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت اللهم اقسم لنا من خشيتك ما تحول به بيننا وبين معصيتك ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا به جنتك ومن اليقين ما تهون به علينا مصائب الدنيا ومتعنا اللهم بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحييتنا واجعله الوارث منا واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا ولا إلى النار مصيرنا وإذا أردت بقومنا فتنة فنجنا منها يا مولانا غير خزايا ولا مفتونين ولا مبدلين ولا مغيرين اللهم لا تدع لنا في يومنا هذا ذنبا إلا غفرته ولا دينا إلا قضيته ولا هما إلا فرجته ولا كربا إلا نفسته ولا مريضا إلا شفيته ولا ضالا إلا هديته ولا سائلا إلا أعطيته ولا مهتديا إلا زدته هدى يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم ارحم أمواتنا وأموات المسلمين وانصر عبادك المجاهدين في كل مكان اللهم انصر عبادك المجاهدين في كل مكان اللهم عليك بالطغاة الجبارين فإنهم لا يعجزونك اللهم عليك بالطغاة الجبارين اللهم أرنا فيهم عجائب قدرتك واشف صدور قوم المؤمنين اللهم آمين أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين والمسلمات من كل ذنب فستذكرون ما أقول لكم وأفوض أمري إلى الله إن الله بصير بالعباد وأقم الصلاة
الله أكبر الله أكبر